In this video, we'll see how to debug an error you encounter when running train.train. As an example, we'll use this script that fine-tunes the BERT model on the Glue MNLI dataset. Check out the videos linked below to see how we came to such a script. Here, we want to learn how to debug the problems in it. Running the script gives us an error pretty quickly. It happens at the line where we feed the inputs to the model, according to the traceback. That tells us there is a problem there, but the problem could come from many different causes. To debug an error in a training, you need to make sure each step of the training pipeline works as intended. This means checking that the inputs of your datasets are correct, you can batch them together, feed them through the model to get a loss, then compute the gradients of that loss before performing an optimizer step. So let's start by looking at the training dataset this trainer is using. There's definitely a problem here. We see text and not number. The error message was telling us the model did not get input IDs, and we do not have those in the dataset indeed. Looking back at our code, we can see we made a mistake and passed the wrong datasets to the trainer. So let's fix that and run again. Now we have a new error. Inspecting the traceback tells us it happens when we try to create a batch, specifically to group the features in a tensor. We can confirm this by asking the trainer to get us a batch of the training data loader, which reproduces the same error. Either by inspecting the inputs or debugging, we can then see they are not all of the same size. This is because we have not passed a data collator to do the padding in the trainer, and didn't pad when pre-processing the data either. Padding inside the trainer is normally the default, but only if you provide your tokenizer to the trainer, and we forget to do that. So let's fix the issue and run again. This time, we get a nasty CUDA error. Those are very difficult to debug because for one, they put your kernel in a state that is not recoverable, so you have to restart your notebook from the beginning. And two, the traceback is completely useless for those. Here, the traceback tells us the error happens when we do the gradient computation with flustered backward. But as we'll see later on, that is not the case. This is because everything that happens on the GPU is done asynchronously. When you execute the model call, what the program does is just stacking that in the queue of the GPU. Then, if the GPU didn't have any current job to do, the work will start on the GPU at the same time as the CPU moves to the next instruction. Continuing with the extraction of the loss, this is stacked into the GPU queue, while the CPU moves to the instruction loss.backward. But the GPU still hasn't finished the forward pass of the model, since all of that took no time at all. The CPU stops moving forward because loss.backward has an instruction telling it to wait for the GPUs to be finished, to make sure the gradients are correct. When the GPU encounters an error, it gives it back to the CPU with a cryptic message, raises the error at the wrong place. So to debug this, we'll need to execute the next steps of the training pipeline on the CPU. It's very easy to do, and we get a traceback we can trust this time. As we said before, the error actually happens during the forward pass of the model, and not loss.backward. It's an index error. With a bit of debugging, we see we have labels ranging from 0 to 2, so three different values, but our outputs have a shape of batch size per 2. Looks like our model has the wrong number of labels. We can indeed confirm that, and now that we know, it's easy to fix it in the code by adding numLabels equal 3 when we create the model. Now the training strip will run to completion. We did not need it, but here is how we would debug the next step of the pipeline, gradient computation, as well as the optimizer step. With all of this, good luck debugging your own trainings.